Hello and welcome to News Laundry Interviews. Today we have with us Shaila Rashid Chhora, who is the current Vice President of the JNU Student Union. Now, Shaila, before I go on to the specific questions, there is a new wave of resistance and inquiry coming out of campuses across the country. How do you see these struggles more as a student than as a student politician or activist?
Students currently, they perceive themselves as being under attack. And that has happened because students have been a very vocal section in society, especially JNU students, but also students of other universities. And generally students, would sort of, you would expect them to be idealistic and, you know, not ready to conform to mainstream political narratives. And that is where this attack comes from. I mean, we have been vocal against Dadri, we have been vocal against Narendra Modi's policies in general. And that is why there is such a major attack. And there is also this whole thing about institutions. The Narendra Modi government is really undermining institutions by appointing people from the RSS cadre, purely from the RSS cadre, who do not have the sort of qualifications to head institutions. And that's creating a friction. Now, in ICHR, in Indian Council of Historical Research, you have Vice Sudarshan Rao, for example. But there, they did not have any students. ICHR doesn't have students. So that is why they didn't have to face anything. But the moment it came to FTII, they ran into students there. And, you know, the moment they installed Gajendra Chauhan there, they had to face resistance.
But then, regardless of the capability of the people who are being installed as the head of this institution, now, no matter what government or what political party is in power, every government or political party likes to install people who are closer to their ideology. Yeah. So this argument doesn't really hold ground per se, as you're saying, against a Modi government.
No, of course, every government does that. But I mean, if you see people under the, I have no special preference for the Congress government that way. But Congress didn't have any sort of obsession to install people from its who are its party members or card holders or something like that. This is a little here is, you know, BJP comes across as a little more dangerous because they install people directly from the RSS cadre, and I mean they have flouted so many norms, in sort of appointments. And that is a really dangerous thing about this government. So that relative autonomy that institutions would have from the government, that is just gone.
Now, coming on to what's been making news for the last 7 days, the rape complaint against Anmol, who is the ex-ISA president. Now, regardless of what political parties or outfit you come from in JNU, almost all parties are very vocal about gender justice. You yourself, I think, had contested the GS Cash election. Now, would you say that this is like a collective failure of the JNU community and the ISA leadership also, that even after so much of awareness and so much activism on gender justice, something of this sort has happened?
Yeah, I think that, ISA in particular has, for example, said that this requires us to go into reflection. And the JNU community also, some days back there was a UGBM here, and you could hear many people saying that, you know, this is not just about one person, we have to look inwards. And that is what I also broadly feel, that this requires us to introspect, and this requires greater sensitization. Sometimes what happens is that we go and talk about very advanced issues, but, you know, those basics of consent, those basics of, you know, not violating someone's bodily integrity, of violating someone's freedom to be, freedom to move, that, you know, I think we need to take a step backward and we need to have conversations about those basic things.
Did he resign voluntarily from the ISA president last year in November or December, or like was it like a party decision?
No, there was an internal complaint by another activist. And that was of a nature which amounted to something like sexual harassment. So at that time he was removed from the state presidentship. That is why right now when this rape case came, That is why we didn't, I mean, you didn't see it in our statements that we are removing him as state president.
He was just a member now. Yeah.
So now he's been removed
but
from the membership.
But given that there was a case like that against him, what were the steps that were taken by ISA in response to that complaint?
Well, first of all, I'm not fully aware of the thing because it was dealt by a senior level leadership. Hmm. So I'm not aware of that, but I know some of the meta details. For example, first, I think the complainant was encouraged to go to the sexual harassment committee and complain there, but she didn't want to do that. So so that is why, I mean, in consultation with her.
So the complainant didn't want to take it ahead?
She didn't want to. She wanted some action within the party. And, you know, there were conversations, I believe, with the with the accused at that time. And there were steps which were taken and he was, I think, put under monitoring or something like that.
Now, moving on, Shaila, this entire debate about nationalism and how easily students from JNU are branded and labeled as anti-national, so much so that I've seen students from JNU going on to primetime television debates and they are being labeled as anti-national. So, like, and you come from Kashmir, that's why this question is very interesting to be put forward to you. How do you see this debate? And do you think there should be one definition of nationalism? And if not, what is your understanding of nationalism?
Nationalism is something that is for consumption by the, you know, by the educated, urbanized, you know, upper middle class masses. Because when we go to school, we are shown this map, which we are, you know, supposed to worship and uphold and everything. For many people who never go to school, they don't even know what the map of India looks like. So this love should not only be for the frontiers of the country, for the borders of the country. It should be for the people of the country. For us, nationalism means just that. And, you know, you need to have, I mean, you need to have a progressive definition of nationalism rather than one that curtails our civil rights. Because, see, here we all come from, I mean, India is such a big country and there are so many diverse identities. What is the basis? There is no basis for holding people together. There is no common language. There is no common dress. There is no common food. What is the basis? The basis is that it is not a linguistic identity. Indian, if you say Indian, it's not a linguistic identity. It's not a regional identity. It's a civic identity. And that civic identity will come only when, I mean, why will people believe in this civic identity? When you give them certain civic rights under this identity.
Okay, so Kashmir is again on boil. I was seeing the address that you gave at the India Today conclave. You said there that growing up in Kashmir, there were a lot of brutal images you had in mind. And there was this anecdote about military officials coming, barging into your house and addressing your grandmother as Budhiya and asking her, why isn't she voting? Now, given that you had experiences like that and you have grown up in Kashmir, and now you are the vice president of one of the foremost student union in the country, was this transition easy?
Yes, because my entry point into left politics was gender. And I think that, you know, you have several experiences as a Kashmiri, you also have several experiences as a woman. And I was in Delhi at the time of the 16 December movement and I just went to India Gate to express my rage and everything. And you know, that rage was not only against one case. But initially when we went there, we were demanding death penalty and all of that. But then it was, you know, listening to people like Kavita Krishnan, you know, speak speak that what really will bring women's emancipation, what really will bring women's freedom. And I think JNU is the best model of that. I mean, here we are absolutely free and absolutely safe. And it does give an alternative in terms of gender. So that was my entry point into left politics. And also, I mean, I think that the only parties which, you know, without caring for the sort of electoral, you know, electoral outcome of, you know, speaking up for Kashmiri people, I think that, you know, in the left and particularly in ISA, you can speak about that. I mean, in other parties, you wouldn't be allowed to talk about Kashmiris because it would upset the, you know, the vote bank of certain parties. So that's why, I mean, left is a space where as a woman, as a Kashmiri, I feel very very much at home.
So let me ask you this, like, apart from obviously the de-escalation of military and repeal of ASPA, do you think there is a need for a referendum, or there should be a referendum in Kashmir?
Yeah, and I think the more this is denied and the more, you know, Indian people are put into denial of this, I think it's going to be very harmful. Because, you know, at times it is just that whole thing about talking to people and giving them the right to talk. Why are we so afraid of, you know, giving people the right to talk? India was a party to the plebiscite, and it was a party to the UN 1948 resolution. And then, you know, Kashmir used to have a very progressive politics. The Kashmir movement was always worker-led. And the, you know, under Sheikh Abdullah, there were many progressive stances on women's education, women's domestic work. There were a lot of progressive developments on that front. But it is India's constant Kashmir policy which has progressively led to this decline in the situation. I mean, Kashmir wasn't like this, and it is, you know, it is continuous denial of the space to talk, space to form parties, space to have free and fair elections, space to even talk about plebiscite, which was a, you know, which was, it was not illegal to speak about plebiscite. It was not seditious. That space has been continuously, you know, shrunk by India's Kashmir policy.
How do you see Prime Minister's comment, or rather the concern, on Balochistan and his independence? Because that's seen as a policy stance now.
It's very shameful. It's very shameful. And I think he's doing more injustice to the cause of Balochistan people, you know, by, I mean, I don't think that the people of Balochistan would want the support of a bigoted Hindutva fascist, you know, dictator. I don't think they would want that.
But
they are fighting against exactly that.
But there is a need to talk about the human rights violations in Balochistan also, right? Like in JNU, you guys talk about the human rights violations in Palestine, but to everywhere possible, from Bastar to everywhere, there is violation. So do you think that comment has given space or agency to the voices of resistance from Balochistan?
No, I don't think. I think it has done more injustice, because the way, you know, a genuine Kashmiri movement is labeled as Pakistan-backed.
Okay.
Now, the Balochistan movement, you know, they will face this in their country. Oh, you are India-backed. I mean, jaise yahan pe Pakistan gaali hai, wahan pe Hindustan gaali hai.
Yeah.
Us tarah se. So, I think that, you know, what...
So, it's
doing
more
create,
harm to the movement,
yes,
you would
say. Yes, I
feel
that. Because, I mean, yes, we have to talk about all self-determination movement. Tibet's government in exile is run from India.
Yeah.
We talk about Balochistan, we talk about everything, but Kashmir, when, you know, you talk about Kashmir, it becomes seditious. So there is an obvious double standard that is, you know, that is happening here. I think that we need to move away from the governments, you know, what the Pakistan government's interest in Kashmir is, what the Chinese government's interest in Arunachal is, what India's interest in Tibet is. And I think that we need to talk about people at a, you know, at a basic level, at a basic level of humanity, and having political rights that is being denied to people in all these regions.
Okay, so coming back to campuses and Lindo, now for our viewers, Lindo committee was set up in 2005 by the UPA government in response to the Supreme Court directive, I think, to curb the money and muscle power. Now that sounds really good and rosy on paper, but ever since the guidelines and came in, students in JNU and a lot of other colleges always had a problem. So could you cite what exactly are the problems with Lindo Commission? Because on paper, if you read it, so for example, it talks about the need for student union in each and every private and government college.
See, the Lindo Committee recommendation, whatever it looks on paper, it is doing exactly opposite of that. First of all, it claims that it will, you know, sort of ensure that elections happen in every university. But there exactly is the first violation of Lindo Committee recommendations. Where are the elections in Jamia Millia Islamia? People in several parts of the country, they are fighting for their right to the union, to have an elected students union. They are not able to have it. And it's a huge joke that, you know, Lindo Committee recommendations will curb money and muscle. What will curb money and muscle is a principled politics. You know, even before Lindo Committee recommendations came to JNU, if any party engaged in, you know, for example, NSUI at one point, there used to be a slogan that note low NSUI se vote do aisa ko, that kind of thing. I mean, if a party here engages in that kind of thing, you know, distributing money or goodies, people themselves will reject that party. And I mean, it works against you in JNU to have money and muscle, because people yourself, people themselves will throw you out if you engage in that kind of politics.
But do you think there is a need for a guideline?
No, I don't think so. Because if there is, I mean, agar Lingdo committee recommendation itna acha hai, to have it in the parliament elections. Then people cannot contest more than once. Narendra Modi cannot contest more than once. There should be an age bar. All of these things are there in the Lingdo committee recommendation. And student politics works with a lot of challenges. I mean, if you have to raise students' issues, you can't be an inexperienced person who is, you know, who is just, I mean, I just finished my union tenure. And by the time I got to know how to get the administration to do things, my tenure is over, and I have no accountability. Even if I ran away in the middle of my tenure, I have no accountability because I don't have to contest again. And then there is this whole thing about disciplinary action. I mean, I have had several fights with the administration when they were harassing the students. I mean, if there's going to be a sort of disciplinary action on me each time that happens, then, you know, I'll not work for the students, I'll work for the administration. You don't want a pro-administration students union, you want a pro-students union. That is, you know, there are many problematic issues in that. And money muscle is still not curbed in DU, Allahabad. You see, there is, you know, loads of money being pumped in. It's like an MLA election.
So even whatever positives were there aren't really converted on the ground. The way you are responding to the question right now, Shaila, is you are taking the JNU model. Now, there are a lot of colleges that lack a constitution for a student union. So what about colleges and campus like that? Would you say that you mobilize people till the time they have certain constitution or they come up with their own system? So would you rather stick to that, or you would say that, okay, colleges that can afford the autonomy, they obviously have their autonomy, and colleges that don't have active, so for example, none of the private colleges right now have student union. So for colleges like that, do you think Lindo makes sense?
No, Lindo committee recommendations were brought in to help the whole project of privatization of education. That's it. This was brought in to make our unions weaker, to make our student leaders inexperienced, so that they can't recognize issues like, now you are introducing part-time courses, you are taking away fellowships, you are hiking fees. This is a project to privatize universities, to commercialize education completely. And the student unions were standing in the way. The Birla Ambani report, it specifically mentions that student unions are standing in the way of privatization of education, and we are proud that we are doing that. We are ensuring education for everyone. And it was after that the LCR came in. So there is a huge deal of hypocrisy around this. Colleges and universities can have their own guidelines and all of that. But you know why this is so farcical? Because people are not given the right to freedom of expression. People, the moment they, you know, protest even for hostels or even for better facilities, for a well-functioning tap of water, they are thrown out of the university. There is disciplinary action against them. And that is why student politics has not been allowed to develop. If student politics is allowed to develop, if people are given the freedom of expression, then I believe that they will come up with a progressive model.
On their own, okay. So when Kanhaiya came back after he was behind the bars, now the speech that was very well received by the mainstream media also, irrespective of the treatment you guys got by the media before that. Now, one of the few anecdotes that he had mentioned, one of them was that how in the jail, he got a red bowl and a blue bowl. Red essentially for communism and blue for the rights of Bahujan or socialism in general. After the suicide of Rohit Vemula and the movement that followed his suicide, there has been a coming together of the Dalit struggles of Dalit students and Dalit in general across the country and the left struggle. How as a student do you see this, or you are of an opinion that this was happening way before the Rohit Vemula movement started?
No, this is true. This was happening before, because due to Dalit assertion on campuses, due to Dalit students coming to campuses and, you know, asserting their rights and, you know, talking about their life experiences, which was otherwise missing from the academia. I mean, the academia was totally unaware, and except if you leave the subaltern studies area, etc. I mean, that there's a general invisibility of tribals in our lives. It's like two railway tracks, their lives are running parallel and we don't know about them. But their main presence, their mere presence in the universities makes our education system richer because it enhances our understanding of the Indian society. So it's because of, you know, Dalit assertion on campuses that I believe that people have become sensitized to the specificity of their issues, the particularity of their issues. And I think that this, you know, coming together has been for a while, you know, at this time, I mean, after the Rohit Vemula thing, it became much more crystallized. But I think that this has been underway for a while. We have serious differences. There are serious differences in the Marxist approach, in the Bahujan approach. But I think that when in the society, it's the Bahujans who are sort of challenging the right wing and challenging the fascist government that is there. I think that we need to rally behind them. And the same thing Muslims will not be able to do because they'll be very easily labeled as ye to terrorist hain, ye to dari wale hain, that kind of thing. The Bahujans are doing that. I mean, if you see in Una right now, that's a very brilliant movement and we need to all back it and support it.
But this intermingling of Lal Salam and Jai Bhim is often criticized by leaders of Dalit student outfits that like since independence and now again it's happening, what left tries to do, and I'm talking about left in general right now, if you could reflect on that, that the left has tried to appropriate Dalit struggle for their own good. So how do you see that playing out within campus politics? Do you agree with that criticism?
No, see, they can have their own initiatives, but as I said that when a marginalized social force is asserting itself, and that is what Comrade Chandrasekhar, who used to be the president of JNUSU and who was, you know, sort of shot dead in Bihar, just like that. What he also said, and that's where we draw inspiration from, that when a marginalized social force is asserting itself, where do you stand? Do you stand against them or do you stand with them? We'd much rather stand with them, you know, rather than stand with these Hindutva fascist forces or any sort of fascist tendency for that matter.
Given the traction or the following that left outfits have in terms of pure voting margins, Dalit student outfits don't have that comfort level. Obviously struggles, you can identify with someone's struggles, but there also is a question of owning and leading someone else's struggle for that matter, and that's where the criticism is.
You know what, see in JNU, even before the Mandal Commission came, you know, you used to have something called the deprivation points so that people from backward regions can come here. So from 83 to 93, deprivation points were not there. But from 93, we sort of, there was an ISA union and we got this restored. We got these deprivation points restored. And deprivation points were given even to OBC candidates. So this is before Mandal 2 came in. So Mandal 2 came in very late. And it came in for higher education, for reservation and higher education. But before that, when there was no Mandal 2, at that time also, we used to have this thing called, you know, deprivation points for OBC students. And when reservation for OBC students came, at that time the deprivation points then was ended because then they had reservation. And you know, this campus is progressive and inclusive because of left politics. You know, I mean, you can say that women's struggle is different, this struggle is different, that struggle is different. Yes, of course it's different, but that is what the, I mean, in the left you yourself have Dalit leaders who have come from very, very marginalized backgrounds. I mean, the last year's general secretary, for example, Chintu, she's from a very, very backward area of Bhojpur, you know, where the Bathani Tola massacres took place. So, you know, there are the Dalit leaders themselves in left who are emerging and who are sort of, you know, raising these issues. And I think that, you know, for example, I wouldn't join a Kashmiri political party or a Muslim political party is because the left unites us on the basis of our marginalization and sort of trains us to, you know, yes, raise questions that matter to us immediately, but also raise questions that matter to others. I mean, when, you know, in the left, the way my political training is, yes, I do feel marginalized as a Kashmiri, but that makes me understand, you know, also the, you know, the marginalization that a Dalit faces, the marginalization that an Adivasi faces, or the marginalization that a Black faces in America. I mean, you start to look at things from a very human perspective, you know, not whether this is my issue or not, that kind of thing.
But does it translate into parties, parent parties or parties that you're affiliated to? So for example, if you see the leadership of CPI or CPM, there has hardly been any. And this was, in fact, this was one of the issues that Rohit Vemula talked about in his Facebook post. So do you think, like in campus, if it is happening there, there's obviously a need for that kind of conversation to happen at the senior or the parties that you guys are affiliated to also?
Yes, I think that this criticism is very valid, that at the student politics level, at the, you know, on the ground, the struggles are connected. On the ground, people are fighting together. Yeah. Dalits, Muslims, they're all fighting together. Mm. But I do feel that the left needs to programmatically engage with, the Bahujan discourse, and it needs to, incorporate all those criticisms in its leadership and everything. If criticisms are arising, those need to be addressed. And I think that'll just make us, criticism doesn't make us weaker, it makes us stronger, I feel.
Mm-hmm. Now, for the last 2 and 3 elections, there have been cries and demands of a so-called left unity ever since the Modi government has come in power. And I've spoken to some of the volunteers in ISA also. Do you think these cries for left unity is because of the growing influence of AVP or Sangh on campuses? Or does it reflect to the inter-student outfit politics within left?
See, for several years here, ISA used to be a very, very dominant force. And, even despite all alliances that were made against ISA, and I'm talking about left alliances, even despite that, ISA would win with a huge margin.
Like the LDF front.
The LPF that was formed. And ISA at that time won a 4-0. It was a clean sweep. But there's a thing happening now that there are many good candidates. There are there's much vote division among the left.
Yeah.
So, and in that division, if you see the entire left vote together, it is increasing. But the division is, because of the division, the right wing could seep in. I mean, this year we had one, seat in the of right wing in at the joint secretary post, and that is why this anxiety is creeping in. That he is using the legitimacy of JNU-SU, and working against JNU, saying shut down JNU, defaming JNU everywhere, saying the JNU is full of terrorists and JNU women are like that. People are very outraged at that, and that is why people want, students in general here want that. They should not be given even a single counselor post.
It's not just the anxiety. AVVP is eating into a large chunk of the voter base. Saurav did win the joint secretary election last year, and I think that was the first time in 14 or 15 years. So it's not just an anxiety. There is a lot of young recruits are going towards AVVP, right?
Well, that is this whole thing of alignment with power. Since there is Modi government in power. The way we started this interview was talking about political appointments. And if you see, today ABP is the fastest recruitment agency among the youth. There are these schemes, Modi government is working in a very clandestine manner and having all these schemes, for example. Yeah. So there are these very small kind of loans, 50,000, 1 lakh, 5 lakh, something. And those are given to people without any verification process, okay?
Yeah.
And finally, what will happen just before their government is over, they will say that, this was a failed scheme. And we are now doing away with this scheme. Yeah. Similarly, there are recruitments. There are, people right now who have been teaching for 7 years as ad hoc in DU, they are not being taken as ad hoc anymore. And people from the ABVP, they are getting appointed in DU as, faculty. And there is that whole angle to that.
To draw parallels with student struggles abroad also. So if you see a lot of campuses in US and Europe right now, there is a big divestment campaign going on against fossil fuel companies.
Mm-hmm.
People who have invested in fossil fuel companies, in oil and petroleum companies, students are being mobilized to convince everyone to divest from those companies.
Mm-hmm.
Now in India, environment as an issue still hasn't found that kind of resonance on campus. The kind of resonance, for example, gender has, the kind of resonance, for example, Dalit movement has.
Mm-hmm.
Environment still has a long way to go to get that kind of resonance.
See, our party, which is the CPIML Liberation, that is the first Marxist party in India to have a position paper on environment.
Yeah.
But I don't think that that's nearly enough. I do think that we need to engage much more with environmental issues, and there is a huge potential for the red and green to come together that way.
Yeah.
And today the biggest movements against capitalist exploitation are being sort of pioneered by the environmentalists. And I think that there we need to engage more. I mean, one of the first things that I did in my tenure was to invite people from people who are working against GM crops and who are working for organic farming, etc. We did invite them here, but not many people turned up for that meeting. There we need to do more, and I think there's a great scope for engagement, because it's the same contradiction that we are working against. For example, this constant, so capitalism produces a discourse that there'll be unlimited progress. And similarly, the way we are functioning is, it's almost like we have unlimited resources. There can't be unlimited progress, there can't be unlimited resources. There has to be an equality, a balance, there has to be a concern for future generations. And that, I think, can bring us together.
If you like that, click here to support us and down here to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and do check out the other stuff we do, like News Laundry interviews, Why So Serious, animations, comics, panel discussions, podcasts, which are really big, and much, much more.